Jack Pearley, African-American traditional music practitioner, historian, folklorist, and ethnographer. I'm also the editor and publisher of the African-American Folklorist newspaper. But tonight, we have the honor of spending an evening with blues legend and historian Corey Harris, an intellectual, academic, and bearer of our traditions. And he painted these portraits that are hanging behind me. Please welcome Corey Harris.
Thank you all so much. Thank you, my brother Lamont. It's so good to be with you all. Welcome everyone around the world tuning in. Want to give you some roots music. Gonna start out with a song I wrote about, maybe about 25 years ago. I got the chicken pox in New Orleans. Had to go to Charity Hospital. Wrote this song. It's called High Fever Blues. Estes is called Everybody's Got to Change Sometime. Thank you.
Just can't wait until I meet my black woman.
be a snowstorm, might be a flat tire. I know you feel me. I want to go back, play a tune I really like from one of the greats. This tune is called "You Gonna Quit Me, Baby, Good As I've Been to You," written by Arthur Blake. Some say he was a Geechee man. I think they were right.
I'm going away. Some days
Mississippi had the most chapters. Yes, indeed. Well, moving right along. Allow me to tune my guitar if you don't mind. Recorded with the Honorable Ali Fanka Touré years ago in Niafunke, Northern Mali. It's a Skip James tune called Special Rider Blues. Thank you.
Special rider here.
Yes, indeed. Gotta tune up a little bit for y'all.
Where you gonna go?
phenom, Mama Africa. Think about the people in Tigray right now who are suffering. Yes. Nigeria. Well, this next tune, wrote a few years ago for a record called Free Waterway. This tune is called Watching You. James wrote this tune. It's called Devil Got My Woman. Tune, What Did Marcus Say? Thank you all. Back to you, my brother. That's a good point. We could talk a long time about that, but this music is a book of life. It's a book of the life of the generations who've come before us. You know, it's a chronicle. It's our CNN, as Chuck D would say. You know, it is a record of where we have been and where we are now and where we're going. That being said, you know, a large part of it is about knowing that it comes from a culture. It's the record of Black people's history, you know? And so it has to be honored. We can't just surgically remove a part of the culture and raise it up as a commodity, but we have to appreciate it as the voice of the culture. Also, we have to realize that there's a code of behavior that goes with this music as well. There's a responsibility, very much similar to, if you know anything about the griots in Mali, Guinea, Guinea-Bissau, Senegal, Ivory Coast. You know, the griot is someone who is first and foremost, he's a master of the word. And the music is just the vehicle that he uses to convey the word to the people. And when we talk about the word, we're talking about a lot of things. We're talking about a code of conduct that guides not only the lowest of us, but the least of us as well. So much that if you're like a king and you act up, you act a certain way that is unbecoming, you're going to be called out in front of the people. Likewise, if you do something that's good, you're going to be called out in front of the people. And the traditional blues has that same function. For example, Sleepy John Nessus was someone who was known for writing a lot of topical songs, praising people in the community, but also calling people out, you know, who were mistreating Black people or mistreating their own people or misbehaving in some other way, you know. So that's very important also, is to realize that we can't just surgically excise a music from a culture. Like, for example, if I were to endeavor to play Chinese music, you know, and we're all free to play whatever music we want. But if I were to do that, then of course it would behoove me to not just study the music, but really to study the culture and to respect the culture, go there, learn the language, have a relationship, but also to be myself when I am expressing myself in that style and realize that I'm expressing myself in that style as myself. I'm not somehow setting aside my personal history or the history of my nation to play this music, you know? So that's a very important point, is that we have to be honest with ourselves and realize that all music around the world is the voice of a culture, and to show it the due respect. And of course, we can all have influences. That's very important. And we can draw influences from wherever, but we have to express ourselves. Music and art is personal expression, expression of your history through whatever means you want, but you should be giving something that is unique and special. Yeah.
So with that being said, there's a couple of ways we can go with this, but I would like to ask you this, because I find it troublesome that black blues musicians, which is even unfortunate that I would have to specify to that point, find themselves having to defend themselves for explaining that not only did this come from a particular people, but those people still partake in this culture.
Yes, yes. Well, you know, that's a big history, you know, but in general, there is a lot of, let's be frank, a lot of anti-blackness in American and Western society. And so with due to our history as coming from an enslaved and colonized people, our culture is not deemed as being as relevant, as powerful, as important as the so-called mainstream culture. So we're still climbing ourselves out of that hole. And when I say ourselves, we're still, as black people, realizing the value of our own self, because so many of us are still and have been in a dynamic where we are trying to be something that we're not, trying to forget our history and trying to claim some other nebulous identity. But if you look at any nation is only as powerful as its conception of itself. You know, the Japanese, they were bombed to smithereens, yet they had their culture. They had their tradition. They had that get up and go in them. They had that that power that made them, even though, and I've been to Japan, you go there, they don't really have a lot of arable land. They don't have a lot of resources. You never hear about oil coming out of Japan or diamonds or gold. Yet, they had an idea that, okay, we're going to fall back on our culture. We're going to use our culture to manufacture things. And they started out copying things that they liked, that they wanted to make, and then they improved upon them. And now they're one of the great economic powerhouses of the world. So it's really about loving your own culture, having self-esteem, so that you can pull yourself out of whatever hole that history and circumstances placed yourself in. So that's where we find ourselves. You know, a lot of what is passed as black culture in the mainstream is actually very, and I'll be frank again, is very degenerate in a lot of ways. It's celebrated to be profane. And a lot of this is very recent in a lot of ways. Of course, we've always had sort of a tension between the sacred and profane, in a sense, like in the blues, you had Hokum blues. But even in that sense, there was still a celebration of community. There were still limits in what was said, what you could and could not do. And nowadays, a lot of the structure and the order that our culture has given us has fallen by the wayside. And so we are really, a lot of us, losing touch with the basics, the fundamentals of our history, with our struggle, where we have been, you know. And so that's one of the reasons why the blues has called to me, is because it has given me a sense of self, a sense of love for my people, and a sense of love for other people around the world as well. Because I realize we all have something to give. We all have a story to tell, and our culture is that. And so we have to celebrate that and celebrate the uniqueness and realize that we all have something to contribute to the discussion. True. Yeah, I mean, if you look at the blues, a lot of people like to say that it comes out of slavery, but that's really only partially the truth. Really, the blues is a reaction, and I have to nod my turban to Chris Thomas King because he brought a lot of knowledge on this subject. The blues is a reaction to blackface minstrelsy because if you look at the history of popular entertainment in America, it started with vaudeville and blackface minstrelsy, which was basically a mockery. People began with white people, but later it was black people doing it too, dressing up in blackface, playing the banjo, and mocking black plantation life down south, making fun of us. And so when you come to the end of the Civil War and Reconstruction, black people started to realize that we had other opportunities. We had a new horizon that we were looking forward to. We had a new identity. And so we began to really use our traditional music and put it into something new, and that was called the blues, where we're talking about our real life, not an imagined mockery of what people would like us to be, not a stereotype, not a caricature, but actually our real life. That's what made someone like Bessie Smith so powerful, because she was a black woman who was not from the middle class, she was not upper class, she was not educated, and she was singing music in a way that local, regular, everyday black folks could get with, could understand, you know, and that was something that was very revolutionary at the time. So I think it's very true what you're talking about is the blues. If you talk about the blues, you have to talk about slavery. You have to talk about terrorism. You got to talk about Jim Crow, police brutality. You know, the blues is the truth. You know, that's all it is. It's the truth. And so we can't really gloss over the truth when we're talking about it. Cornel West said something about the blues not being pessimistic, that we're an optimistic people, but the blues is the truth. And sometimes that truth is very dark, but it has to be told. You can't ever heal a wound, you can't ever heal a sickness if you don't talk about it. Nostalgia is something, you know, it has its place, But I feel that really, if we're going to talk about the music, about the blues, we have to engage it honestly. We have to talk about all of the history, you know? And so there is a lot of people who follow the music who like to engage and dress up and put on behaviors that are not really of themselves. But the music calls for us to be true to ourselves. You know, no matter who you are, if you come to the music, it's going to expose you for who you really are. So you might as well just be who you are in the music, you know, because if you don't, it's going to come out. It's going to be obvious, you know. And so someone once told me, I wrote about this a while ago. He said, wow, you know, you sound so much like those old blues players from back in the day. Don't you just wish that you were in 1930s Mississippi? And I'm like, hell no. I don't wish I was back there, you know. I'm glad where I am here now. I give thanks for the people, you know. I got people from Louisiana. I got people from Arkansas. I got people from Kentucky and Texas, you know, who escaped from slavery, you know. I am thankful for their sacrifice. But I'm not going to say I wish I was back there, because I know how real it was. I know the sacrifice they went through so that I don't have to go back. You know what I mean? So, yeah.
Which, I did say that was the last question, but you said something. I have to talk about this, because in lieu of keeping it true to yourself as an artist, and of course we're not here to downplay anyone, but this is kind of a two-part question. One, the notion of people in today's world, I won't even say the last 20, 30 years, just now singing blues, and talking about picking cotton things, not referencing it and putting it into context, but actually the caricature for the sake of blues.
Yeah.
Right? And then I would like you to follow up with your penmanship, because you write and pen a lot of articles that I think people should read and understand what's really being said. Because I don't think they're understanding what, not all, but I think that there's a small percentage of people that are not really receiving the message, and I would like you to speak power to that.
Yeah, well, you know, I remember when LeBron James was on Twitter talking about, I believe it was after Ahmaud Arbery was killed, and he was very vocal, and still is, about his opinions about social justice, and the commentator Laura Ingraham on Fox News said, just shut up and dribble, you know, and a lot of the black blues musicians are in a similar position where we're expected to shut up and play. And a lot of that I tie to our history as being from an enslaved and colonized people, where we're expected to entertain. We have a long history of being entertainers. And even though the music is telling the truth, a lot of people in the mainstream, and even black folks, don't want to really hear that truth. You know, they just want us to entertain and to make that money for the system. But it's a much deeper than that. We have a calling, you know? And so when I write, it's the same as when I'm playing music. It's like the ancestors are telling me, yo, you've got a duty. You can't just be out here just playing like, you know, everything's hunky-dory and pretending. We have a mission, you know, because a lot of people were not able to talk about this. It was illegal. Even what we're doing right now was illegal. You know, black people, that's why the black church, as you know, was so strong, because we couldn't meet nowhere in numbers. You couldn't go nowhere in more than two or three people in the South. You know, if you're caught with the Chicago Defender, you that could be your life. You know, talking about the Chicago Defender newspaper. So, you know, this is a time where we have certain freedoms that have been hard fought for and won. So it really behooves us to stand up, be counted, and speak that truth to power. Because if we don't, no one is going to do it for us. And that goes for any nation. No one is going to tell your story Like, you can tell it, you know?
Yeah. I agree. So now I want to get to this Q&A from one of the audience members as we begin to wrap up.
Mm-hmm.
I believe it's Sperling C asks, I'm going to put this up here.
Mm-hmm.
Johnny Cash tribute album rather than say I walk the line?
Oh, that's a great question. Wow, that's someone who's been listening a long time, because that was before the internet. I recorded that song. Yeah, well, you know, I always had a lot of respect for Johnny Cash, because Johnny Cash didn't give a damn about what Nashville said. He said, this is how it is. I don't like how black folk are being treated. I don't like how Native American being treated. He was someone who, even though he came out of a real hard situation where he himself had demons that he had to deal with, he was someone who was aware of right and wrong. And especially at a certain point in his life, he cleaned his act up and was really trying to speak about the real issues, you know? And so I really respected that. And I saw in his own life, the concept of redemption being played out, you know, how he just was unafraid, unapologetic in his approach to the music. He didn't care what people thought. So really, it was, in a way, my tribute to him doing that song instead of something else, because everyone did I Walk the Line. But to me, redemption, it spoke to me also as an African, you know, because it spoke about our struggle as well. So, yeah, respect to Johnny Cash. And I understand that, in fact, we recorded that record just the year before he passed away, and it came out a few months before he died. And I understand he got to hear the whole record and that he liked it. So, you know, that was something that made me very happy. It's true. It's true. I think, you know, Nashville still sees him as problematic. You know, even though he's revered, you know, he's kind of like a rebel, an outlaw. He didn't go with the system.
That'll be a whole nother discussion. Because we know everyone loves the rebel and the outlaw, but for the black experience on America, it's totally different than what people.
Yes, indeed.
Yes, sir. So I definitely will have to write this down so I can make sure I remember to make sure you all come back the next couple of Fridays, because Corey will be doing this again. It is called Exploring the Blues with Corey Harris, and it's coming from Symphony Space in New York City. If y'all love the blues, then y'all need to be here these next two Fridays, and mm-hmm. I hope y'all enjoyed this one, because I sure did.
Mm-hmm. And just so y'all know, it's on the December 11th, we'll be joined by Cedric Watson from Louisiana, Creole man doing a lot of Zydeco, Creole music, La La, Jure, all that good stuff from down in South Louisiana. A real four-time Grammy nominee, a real powerhouse of American music. And on the 18th, we'll be featuring Mr. Alvin Youngblood Hart. I'm a big fan. I've always been a fan of Alvin. He's my brother, my big brother, coming out of Mississippi, also California, a monster on electric and acoustic guitars. So that's, again, December 11th, Cedric Watson, December 18th, Alvin Youngblood Hart. So don't miss it.
Right. Yes. Tuning out from Symphony Space.
Yes, bless. Y'all be well.